Computer Science and Engineering Colloquia features accessible talks by leading computer scientists and computer engineers from across the region and around the world.
Welcome to the Ben Taskar Memorial Lecture. I first met Ben when I was in graduate school about 17 years ago. It's been a little while. My first impressions of him were, this guy is smarter, more knowledgeable, and more accomplished than me. And he's just an undergrad, and I'm a PhD student. Ben was an exceptional human being who changed my life for the better in a deep, transformational way. Ben was so broad, with an incredible love and deep knowledge of literature, art, photography, and The Daily Show, which at that time was with Jon Stewart. He had a contagious smile and a clever sense of humor, and loved to tell jokes. Besides being an amazing friend, he was also an amazing researcher. After graduate school, Ben went on to have an incredible, successful career as a researcher. He received many prestigious awards, published impactful work, and was recognized as one of the best researchers of his generation. And he was really good at light switches. In fact, he was a leader in machine learning, he was a leader in computer vision, and he was a leader in natural language processing. As academics, the rest of us can only hope to be a leader in one field, and Ben was a leader in three fields. Ben had a passion for developing accessible technologies and bringing them to the real world, way beyond the university, to people who really wanted to develop a cool device that would help a particular individual. To carry on this mission, the University of Washington has launched the Taskar Center for Accessible Technology. I'd like to invite the center's director, Anat Kaspi, to tell us a little bit more about the center.
Hello, my name is Anat Kaspi. I am the director of the now year-old Taskar Center for Accessible Technology. As Carlos mentioned, we are trying and aspiring to provide accessible, real-world applications that can be used by people with disabilities, with a focus on motor and speech impairments. The center has launched a number of different programs, but at the very core, we practice participatory design, which has really allowed us to engage a wide community of participants, from students and researchers to reaching outside to the community. And many of you are present here today, and I thank you very much for your participation. So with no further ado, I'd like to allow the speaker to take over, but I thank you for the opportunity to be here and develop within the university's scope, but reach out to a larger community of participants and users and designers that allow us to take the technology further and past the university's walls. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Anat. The center represents a legacy of Ben's work, but we've also established this Ben Taskar Memorial Lecture to bring some of the most distinguished individuals in the world to talk about research and education in areas that were important to Ben. Today is a great pleasure for me to introduce Daphne Koller to be the inaugural speaker for this lecture. Daphne is a world-renowned leader in machine learning. She's the president and co-founder of Coursera, an open online education platform which is touching the lives of millions of people today. Previously, she was the Rajiv Motwani Professor of Computer Science at Stanford University, where she was also Ben Taskar's PhD advisor, and in fact, my PhD advisor too. Daphne has been recognized in a number of different ways. She was one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential people in 2012. In 2010, she was one of Newsweek's 10 most important people. She received the HKI Computers and Thought Award, the MacArthur Genius Foundation Genius Fellowship, and she's been inducted into the National Academy of Engineering and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. I can't think of a better person to inaugurate this lecture series, so please join me in welcoming Daphne Koller.
Thank you. It's a great honor to be here today, even if one that's very bittersweet. Ben was indeed one of my PhD students, as was Carlos. And I'm still trying 2 years later to wrap my mind around the tragedy of Ben's premature death. Carlos already said a few words about Ben. I'm not going to repeat all of the honors and awards. I'm just gonna share just a few thoughts about Ben before I launch into today's lecture. Ben was a really unique individual in a number of ways. You have people who are nice, but are not necessarily awesome at their jobs, and you have people who are amazing scientists, but they're not always the world's nicest people, and Ben was an amazing combination of both. He was gentle, he was generous, he was kind, he was beloved by everyone. He was always helpful to his fellow students and generous to everyone with advice and thoughts. He was, at the same time, an amazing researcher. I remember him, as Carlos does, from his earlier undergraduate days, where he was one of the brightest undergraduates that I'd ever had the opportunity to advise. When he finished his undergraduate, I told him with very mixed feelings that, of course, he should apply broadly, which indeed, to graduate schools, which indeed he did, but I was really delighted when he decided to stay at Stanford and stay in my group and do some amazing research. As a PhD advisor, my favorite moment in a PhD student's career is the time when the student argued with me and turned out to be right. For many students, that takes a while. With Ben, it happened very early on. And the paper around which this happened is the seminal paper on which Carlos is a co-author of Max Margin Markov Networks, which can be said to have launched basically an entire discipline within machine learning, one which is still enormously influential even today and has really, in some sense, transformed the way in which we think about many prediction problems. Somewhat ironically, almost magically, if you will, this morning I got an email from a student in Tehran who asked today, of all days, for the data set that underlies that paper so that he could use it in furthering his research. This is 12 years after the publication of the paper. I don't know very many papers where 12 years later people still care about the data and about the results, and it's still having an impact. And so I think that really, I think, helps show Ben's amazing legacy as both a human being and a scientist, and it's a real privilege for me to be here today. So with that, I'm going to launch into the talk and warn you in advance that this talk doesn't really bear on the work that Ben did with me while he was in my lab. It's what I've been doing for the last 4 years. However, if you wait till the very, very last slide, you will see that at least there is some connection to Ben's heritage in terms of the Taskar Center for Accessible Technology. So bear with me until the last slide. So the work that I'll be telling you about today is the work that we've been doing on making education as a whole accessible to a much, much larger number of people than have ever had that access or that opportunity. So the history of this project, which is, as you saw from the title, only 4 years old. In fact, this month marks the 4-year anniversary of the founding of Coursera. So 4 years ago at Stanford, we took a Stanford classroom of 400 people, actually Andrew Ng's machine learning class, as it happens, and we put it out there for everyone around the world to take for free. From that one experiment, all of a sudden, that class and the two others that launched with it, artificial intelligence and databases, all from computer science, became a global classroom of 100,000 people. And for us, that was a pivotal moment in realizing that there was this incredible hunger around the world for high-quality education, because what's amazing about this is not the number of people alone, but the diversity. These were people from every country, every age group, and every walk of life. And the emails that came in of, this course changed my life, it turned my life around, were such that we realized that we couldn't just step away and go back to writing some more papers, as influential as those might be. And so Andrew and myself, and a number of others from Stanford, created Coursera, and today, actually this number is out of date because I think we crossed 17 million a few days ago. That global community numbers 17 million learners from all over the world, and talk a little bit about those statistics later. So the vision that underlies this effort from the very beginning is this vision statement. We envision a world where anyone, anywhere, can transform their life by accessing the world's best learning experience. And I'd like to highlight three key phrases in that vision statement. The first is anyone, anywhere. We want this to be something that has no boundaries, no boundaries of financial means, no boundaries of geography, of life background, or of physical ability. We want to provide an educational opportunity that is not edutainment, but is life transforming, of the kind that you would get if you attended a university like Stanford or the University of Washington. And the last piece is best learning experience. In order to be transformative, you really have to provide something that has durable, lasting value. And in order to do that, you have to do the best learning experience. And clearly, there's a long way to go on each of these. We're nowhere close to achieving this vision, but that's where we'd like to go. So I'm going to talk, this talk has three parts. The first is going to talk about what these courses are like. The second is going to talk about the impact that it has on our partner universities who are creating these courses, people like Carlos and Emily and others. And the final is going to talk about our learners and the impact that this is having on the lives of learners. So the courses that are being offered currently on MOOC platforms such as Coursera are not what you would think of when people, when you read the media reports of, oh, these are only courses in math and computer science. That is just not true. Certainly math and computer science are well represented, but there's currently over 1,400 courses across the spectrum of human knowledge. There's courses in philosophy, in entrepreneurship, in medicine, music and other performing arts, teaching, teacher professional development, and many, many more. Furthermore, by taking these courses and creating them explicitly and deliberately for the online experience, you can move away from the kinds of constraints that you have when teaching in a physical classroom and really let your imagination go wild. And so first of all, you are no longer constrained to the standard time blocks of whatever, 75 minutes. You can create video units of, that are short, punchy, and capture exactly a unit of learning. So 6 minutes, 8 minutes. Second, you can really do stuff that is completely outside the box. You can go on site and show where Alan Turing invented the computer. You can do programming as you're teaching. I mean, there's a lot of things that you can do here that you just cannot do in a traditional classroom. The second thing is that because this online experience involves a range of assessments, exercises that provide you immediate feedback, you can actually enable mastery learning in a way that in a traditional college setting, where it can take 2 to 3 weeks between the time that you learn a concept and the time that you get the homework, submit it, and get the grade back, you can really have a much tighter cycle of learning that allows a learner to know, wait, I'm not getting this, let me try again and do better, which means that you can now get to the point that before a learner moves to the next stage of the course, they have a firm foundation for the previous one and really get much better learning outcomes in this way. And we're seeing that in the data that we have, that learners who do this actually do perform better in the course as a whole. Now, auto-graded assessments of the kind that you provide, that we provide here, that provide computerized feedback, are actually much broader in their applicability than you think. And that's due to the innovation of our instructors. So here's one of my favorite courses that really demonstrates out-of-the-box use of auto-graded assessments. This is Professor Mike Schatz from Georgia Tech, who teaches a course called Introductory Physics with Laboratory. So you kind of scratch your head a little bit and say, how can you teach a physics lab class when you have learners in Nigeria and Bangladesh who have never seen the inside of a lab? So what Mike did is he had these learners do the experiments using objects that are naturally found in their own environment, like, you know, a basketball court, and this you can see this girl shooting a hoop. And the learners videotape the experiment on their cell phone. And he developed really cool image processing software that tracks moving objects so that he can measure velocities and accelerations and compute whether the student actually performed the experiment correctly or not and did the calculations correctly. So this is really cool and allows people all over the world to engage in experiments. So this is part one of the story. I'm going to foreshadow something that we get to later and tell you part two, which is Mike's students in Georgia Tech, who have access to world-class lab facilities, looked at this and said, wait a minute, why are these learners all over the world getting to do these fun experiments that involve basketballs, whereas we have to do the cookie-cutter experiments that have been the same way for 15 years? We want to do this too. And so now Mike took all of his students out of the Georgia Tech labs, and they're doing exactly this. And then they're coming to class for a flipped classroom experience where they tell each other how they did the experiment and other people critique them. And he says he's never had a group of students as engaged and as excited about physics as he had since he started teaching in this way. So I think there's many nice examples like this where people innovate in their teaching in this format and then bring that back to how they teach on campus. So auto-graded assessments, as I said, the scope is larger than you might think, but they don't cover everything. Clearly, there is a lot of assignments where you still need the kind of insight that only a human can provide. And so in order to make that feasible, we combined ideas from crowdsourcing with the notion of peer feedback that was developed at UCLA and basically allowed learners to create both qualitative and quantitative feedback for assignments that were generated by other learners. And it turns out that if this is well constructed, you can get feedback that is about the same quality as you would get from a teaching assistant. Maybe not like you would get from the instructor, but pretty high quality. And the way that this is done is that the instructor writes a very carefully structured grading rubric that asks the learners to answer specific questions about the work of their peers. And by doing that and aggregating those and averaging those across a number of people who are giving feedback, you actually get pretty reliable grades. Now, that's nice in and of itself because it allows us to scale the kind of courses that you wouldn't think can be done as a MOOC, and I'll give examples in a moment. But the other thing that it allows us is it turns out that this is a really valuable form of pedagogy because giving people critical feedback about their work is an incredibly valuable learning experience. You have to think about what makes a piece of work good versus not so good. And in many cases, our instructors then ask the learners to reflect on the work that they themselves did and see whether, judged by the same criteria, they think their work is up to standard or not. And that really causes a level of introspection and understanding that you don't get by simply getting a grade back at the end of the day. So one of the consequences of this is that many of the instructors who initially used this in the MOOC purely for scaling purposes are now using peer grading in their on-campus classrooms, despite having enough TAs, simply because it provides a great learning experience. So as I said, this actually allows us to open the door to a range of courses that you wouldn't think can be done at the scale of thousands or tens of thousands of people. One of those is this design class from the Wharton Business School at the University of Pennsylvania. And this is an 8-week project class where each week you have to build up, starting from a problem statement, then a concept, then a prototype, and so on. And each week you get feedback from 5 of your peers, so that by the end you've gotten 40 pieces of feedback, which has helped the learners in these classes construct some pretty amazing artifacts, several of which have led to companies that these learners founded based on the ideas that they came up with in the course. So this is an example of, you know, a project class at scale, which is pretty cool. The notion of peer assessment really, I think, relies heavily on the fact that this is an amazing community of learners that forms around these courses. And what you see is that as a part of the course, entire communities of people from all over the world come around and come together and talk about their perspectives about the course material. And in some cases, this is particularly insightful, for instance, in the humanities courses like international human rights law, where you have people from China talking about international relations versus people from the Netherlands and people from the United States. And it really creates a diversity of perspectives that you would never get in a traditional college classroom. And in many cases, we've seen that this also helps open up the minds of the instructors to a global diversity of perspectives. But the other place that this also happens is in more technical courses as well. One of my favorites is actually a nanotechnology course where a lot of the learners in the course were practicing, were practitioners in the field who were thrown into the same class with the newbies, and it really created an interesting dialogue about this is how this is used in practice that helped create much better and richer project experiences than, again, you would get in a typical college class. This global community also creates opportunities for these courses to touch the real world in new and interesting ways. And again, there is a whole range of examples. I'm going to give this one as one of my favorites again. This is a social psychology class, which up until recently was the single largest MOOC ever offered. It was about a year ago. I think it got beaten out by another. This is a social psychology class from Wesleyan that had 250,000 people in a single session. Now, the interesting thing is, for those of you familiar with Wesleyan, it's a small liberal arts college where the typical class size is between 12 and 20. And yet, you had this instructor who had 250,000 people. The final project in this class was called Day of Compassion. And the learners in this class had to live 24 hours embodying the virtue of compassion and then summarize and analyze their experiences using the tools of social psychology. This was peer graded, and then the best of the best that got the highest peer grade scores was selected to receive a grand prize, which in this case was travel to Stanford to meet the Dalai Lama. So let me tell you about this final project. This is Balesh Jindal, who is a physician from India, whose goal was to do something about the problem, the pervasive problem of sexual violence against girls and women in India. So she went to this local girls' school adjacent to her that had 2,000 girls from lower income families. She brought them together in groups and talked to them about sexual violence and what it means, and identified dozens of cases of girls that had been abused by a teacher, a family member, a neighbor, and is offering them or offered them pro bono consulting in her clinic. And not only did she do that, she got so inspired by this that she got several of her fellow physicians to do the same for other girls' schools in the region. So when you think about this, you think about the following. In Scott Plouse's class of 250,000, several thousand people submitted the final project. This is one of them. It might be the best of the bunch, maybe, but there were others that were also amazingly inspiring and impactful on the learner's environment. So Scott Plouse in his Wesleyan class might touch the lives of 20 or 30 people. In this class, he touched directly the lives of thousands, and indirectly the lives of who knows how many tens of thousands more. So this is an amazing opportunity for a faculty member to make a dramatic impact in the world. So those are courses, and now wrapping up the next level of this is we talked about transformative change. Individual courses, as in this example, can sometimes demonstrate that change. But in many cases, learners need a much larger unit of learning than just a single 4 or 5 week course. And in order to do that, we created a couple years ago the notion of a specialization, which is a sequence of courses that stack together to teach someone a valuable skill that culminates in a capstone project that allows them to demonstrate the application of that skill in the context of a real world problem. We are delighted that the University of Washington has offered 3 of those specializations, 2 from right here in computer science, the machine learning specialization, and a big data specialization, and just this week, a business English specialization launched as well. And we find that the learners in these specializations get a dramatically bigger impact on their lives because of the larger unit of learning that's offered. Very recently, as a very new move, which also launched this week, it was a big week for us at Coursera, is going from specializations to degrees. So in the same way that a specialization is a stackable series of courses, you can view a degree not as a monolithic whole, but as a set of specializations. So in this week, we launched the IMBA with the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And it's a full MBA that's constructed unbundled, if you will, as a set of specializations, six specializations, that you can decide as a learner, if all you want is one, that's totally fine. You can take digital marketing and go run Facebook campaigns. Or you can take two or three, and somewhere along the way you say, shoot, this is really cool, I can do this, and you apply then. So you don't have to decide up front. You can decide halfway through, and because you're halfway through, the university knows that you're awesome, even if your undergraduate transcript it might not be up to par. And so this gives paths to opportunity to people that might not normally make their way into a top quality MBA, and also allows the university to construct really outstanding cohorts of people who are from non-traditional backgrounds. So again, opening up access to opportunity. So this concludes the first part of the talk. The next part I'm going to talk about is the impact that this has had and can have on the partners, the universities and the instructors that provide the content for these courses. So we're really proud to say that we currently have, actually again, this slide should be updated, close to 150 partner universities from 26 countries in six different continents. We're very proud that we got our first African university just a couple months ago, University of Cape Town. And that really allows us to offer a world-class education from institutions that range from places like Stanford and Yale and University of Washington, of course, and Princeton and Penn and so on, but also University of Sao Paulo in Brazil, University of Cape Town in South Africa, and Peking University and Taiwan University, and many others. And this is really an exciting opportunity to create a body of knowledge that offers a very broad diversity of perspectives that are given by different expertise in different local cultures of these different universities. One of these universities, as I mentioned, is University of Washington, is one of our earlier partners, and as such has pretty amazing numbers. 2.8 million distinct enrollments in your courses, over 1.1 million unique learners who have been touched by these courses. 37,500 course completions. Think about how that relates to the number of graduates of the University of Washington, and this is in only 2.5 or so years. And there's a tremendous opportunity because there's a lot of great courses that have been offered and specializations and more coming, and we're really excited about the potential here. Now, one interesting thing about these learners is that they're not the ones that you would normally reach. So this is what we call an awareness map. And when a learner signed up for a University of Washington course, we asked them, had you previously heard of the University of Washington at all? As in, were you even familiar with the name? Dark green are ones that have a very high awareness rate. And as it gets closer to light green and red, it basically is a very low awareness rate. And you certainly see that the University of Washington is doing really well in Russia, very well in the United States and Canada. But then as you get into, say, Latin America and Africa and, actually not in Russia, sorry, this is China. I'm sorry? Mongolia. And Mongolia too, we're very big in Mongolia. You specifically, Pedro, very big in Mongolia. So it reaches new audiences that are very different from the ones that you would normally reach. Now, this has a lot of downstream benefits. So for instance, even a university as reputable as the Wharton Business School, one of the top two or three in the world, sees the benefit of this. So this is from Dean Jeff Garrett, who says that for them, this allows them to identify talent from a pool of participants who might not have considered business education before. They're not looking to grow the number of their students, but it allows them to have an even more broad population of people. And it touches the lives of individual faculty. So this is actually one of my favorite examples. This is Professor Bert Blokken from TU Eindhoven, which is a technical university in the Netherlands. Very high caliber of teaching, but doesn't have the same, say, worldwide reputation as, say, the University of Washington. Bert taught his course on aerodynamics, and by doing so, reached graduate students who we would never otherwise have met. And he got two fully funded, plus one extra for which he immediately got funding, who all came to his lab to do a PhD with him as a direct consequence of taking his MOOC. So Bert's like, I got an instant lab. This is cool. So in addition to direct interaction with the students who come to the university, as I mentioned earlier, this also creates an opportunity for the instructors to engage with a much broader population of learners than they would normally see. So I'm going to read you a couple of quotes from our instructors, but really this is pervasive. You talk to any instructor, they'll say the same thing. So this is Professor Charles Severance from University of Michigan, fondly known as Dr. Chuck. Dr. Chuck says, the greatest joy of teaching so many students, approaching a million, he has a very popular Python specialization, is being exposed to the amazing diversity of those who want to learn. When you spend your career at a university, you interact with a highly filtered population and slowly develop a very narrow view of the median learner. In MOOCs, that median learner we see in higher education, face-to-face classrooms, is notably absent, and we meet all the rest of the learners. That's Dr. Chuck. This is another one of my favorite stories. This is Professor Jacqueline Michelle Emia from Ohio State, who taught a course on human trafficking, a very painful and complex topic. And she says this course brought attention to human trafficking in 187 nations. These past 28 days have been the most impactful of my career to date. I've talked to more survivors because of this course, and I've been privileged to interview in my 18 years as a researcher. Specifically, one of the ones that she talked to, a learner filed a lawsuit against his trafficker once he remembered and then realized that what he had experienced was legally trafficking. He said that this course saved him and that he plans to save others with the monies he expects to be awarded from his lawsuit. So coming back to impact again. Impact can be local or it can be more global. This is another one of my favorite examples. This is Professor Madhu Viswanathan, who is from the University of Illinois, taught a course in subsistence marketplaces, was absent when I visited the University of Illinois because he was in Geneva sitting on the United Nations Commission for the Refugee Situation in Syria, which he had been invited to join because of the impact of the course that he had taught. So again, a tremendous opportunity for impact. Finally, I'd like to talk about the impact on pedagogy, which I referred to a little bit earlier. There are many ways in which professors benefit from, in terms of the pedagogy they develop in teaching these online courses. The most obvious one that people think of first is flipped classroom teaching, where they have their on-campus students watch the MOOC before coming to class, and then they spend the class time in much more rewarding ways than just lecturing, but rather on much more interactive and engaging activities. So this is Professor Scott Rixner, a computer scientist from Rice University, who says, I will never, ever, ever teach a class any other way. This is so much better, the students learn so much more. I will never get up here and lecture. I just don't see the point anymore. Now, this is not just something that the instructors see as beneficial. It turns out that the data support this. So this is data from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, who I will say have been doing flipped classroom teaching for well over a decade, long before MOOCs ever came onto the scene. And they've become really good at it. So this is data from an introductory electrical and computer engineering course, but they've seen similar results in others. And what you see here on the left is the distribution of grades in a traditional lecture class for this course in 2011. And what you see on the right is the same course with the same level of rigor taught in a flipped classroom model the following year. And what you see as the most notable difference is that the students who are failing in the original version are now passing the course. And they've reduced the failure rate in this course from 30% to about 5%. Now, when you ask yourself why that is, think about the learning experience in a large lecture hall from the perspective of a student who is not as well prepared as you might hope. They're sitting there, the class is going along, and at some point they lose a point that the instructor makes because maybe they don't have the necessary background. If they don't quickly catch up, the rest of the lecture is effectively a dead loss. And so if in a blended learning format, they have the option of saying, wait a minute, I didn't get that. I'm gonna pause and rewind and think about it, maybe ask a question on the forums before I move on. And so the rest of the lecture isn't a dead loss. Furthermore, the class time itself, where the students come together and jointly solve problems under the supervision of the instructor and the teaching assistants, is also an incredibly valuable time, because when you really get into the heart of it and encounter a really tough challenge that you don't know how to handle, the instructor is there and you can ask them a question, as opposed to get lost and submit an assignment where you don't know what you're doing. And so for both of these reasons, we see in these data and others that blended learning not only helps increase pass rates, but really helps the students who are the most disadvantaged in terms of their background. So finally, I'd like to talk about the value of data in improving pedagogy, because I think that is something that might not be quite as obvious until you actually encounter it, which is the ability of an instructor to get an immediate and very data-driven insight into what in their course is working and what is not. And that happens both in a qualitative way as well as in a quantitative way. Qualitatively, the students in the forums, they will tell you what they think of your course, whether you want to hear it or not. And as a consequence, you get a tremendous amount of feedback. For instance, here we've actually just recently added an ability to flag problematic content, and you can see that there are content items that have received a lot more downward thumbs, like installing MATLAB on Windows got 49 flags. It's like, okay, maybe I need to do this one a little bit differently. And you can see this is Pavel Pevsner, again, a computer scientist from UC San Diego, saying, where else would we get a goldmine of comments contributing to further improvements of our courses? And then, of course, you also have behavioral data, for instance, ones that you can see which quiz questions only 30% of the people got right. And maybe that's an indication either the question is ill-formed or the preceding lecture was not very clear. And again, those are insights that can then be brought back to the face-to-face classroom. Finally, and this is, you know, only relevant for a subset of people, but for those that it is relevant, they get really excited about this. This is the opportunity to create a new branch in data science. We've already done, we've already turned astronomy into a data science by things like the Hubble Space Telescope, which allows you to have a universe-wide view of how, of the whole of the universe. Or biology, where things like high-throughput sequencing have allowed us to get a completely different view of biology and disease and so on. You can now imagine taking data-driven insights on, for instance, how important it is for instructor to be engaged, what type of engagement is important, how condensed should a course be, what pedagogical techniques are beneficial or not, and turn the study of human learning from something that's qualitative and anecdotal to something that's a data science. And this could, in principle, give rise to a step function in human learning. So the final piece of this talk is on the learners and the kind of implications that it has on them. So I'm going to start with a few statistics on our learner population. You can see here the breakdown. Only about 30% of our learners are from North America, 9% from Latin America, including Mexico, 27% Asia, Africa, Asia and Europe, 4% Africa, which is surprisingly high when you consider internet penetration. We're very proud of the statistic that says that 40% of our active learners come from emerging economies. And I think one important stat to add to that is that when you look at the actual data, it's not concentrated in a few countries. It's really, we have learners in every single country around the world. I used to have to say every country except North Korea, but a few enterprising North Koreas somehow managed to tunnel through and we found them, so it'd be interesting. Here's some other demographic statistics, which we'll come to in a moment interpreting what they mean. On the left-hand side, you see the age demographic, and you can see that we have about 30% in the 18 to 24-year-old category, but the largest number by far is the 43% that are the mid-career 25 to 35-year-old range. And then there is a very long tail that basically spans every age group from 13 to 90. Of the learners, about 55% are employed full-time, but that means that 45% are not employed full-time, and we'll come to those as well when we talk about some of the impact that this is having. And then on the right-hand side, there is a graph that you can interpret in two ways. 75% of our learners have at least a bachelor's degree, sometimes an advanced degree. So you can think about this as, well, are you reaching people who don't need the education? And I'll come back to that in a moment. But the other way of looking at it is the 25% of the 16 million people that we have, which is only 4 million, don't have a degree. So that's two ways of looking at it. These data can be really well interpreted when you start thinking about learner motivations. And largely speaking, you can break these down into three categories, although I will tell you they very much overlap in many ways. There is a population, about 15% in the US, larger in emerging economies, as many as 30% in a country like India, who are college focused. These are people who are either pre-college, looking to become better prepared to go to college, or in college and are finding their current educational opportunities at their institution to be inadequate in terms of the quality. You can see they skew very young, as you would expect, and they mostly take courses in introductory STEM. Not only, but that's the majority. Second category, large in the United States, as many as 30%. Smaller, again, in countries that people don't have the luxury for this kind of learning, is the enrichment learners. You can see a much broader age distribution. And they take courses that are really all over the map. I couldn't even make a list here. Courses in humanities and arts and environment and education and so on and so forth. Really everything. And these are people who are taking courses purely for the joy of learning. Finally, our single largest category, 50-plus percent globally, much higher percentages in developing countries, are the career seekers. These are people who are taking courses because they want to have a transformative effect on their career. The by far largest categories of courses that make a difference to these people and the ones that they take are in business, technology, and data science. The next ones are education and engineering. And we'll talk a lot about these people in the rest of this. So let's interpret why you have so many people who are looking at these career-relevant courses for taking them online. So let's give a little bit of background context on global trends. 91% of millennials change their jobs in less than 3 years. This is a shocking number for people who haven't seen it before. But it means that every 3 years or less, people shift jobs. And in many cases, the new jobs that they have require skills that they don't have, and in many cases, didn't even exist when they went to school. Skills like data science didn't really exist as a discipline 15 years ago. And specifically, if you think about the next stage, 65% of tomorrow's jobs don't exist today, so this need for continuing education is not going away. Now, in fact, it turns out that 58% of employers worldwide believe that new college grads are just not adequately prepared for work either. So it's not just a matter of how far you are from your degree, it's also a matter of, based on which college you went to, you may not be skilled for the job even today. India is a good case in point. Most large employers in India, like Tata and Infosys, have their own universities. These are not universities that are a substitute for the existing universities. This is after you finish the regular university. You spend another year at the Infosys University to become sufficiently employable that they could actually use you. So this is a real issue in parts of the world where there's just insufficient capacity for high-quality education. So when you look at the people, the 75% of people on our site who already have degrees, that's a lot of them right there. So when you think about those 52% of our learners who are career focused, what is it that we can do to help them? So first of all, they need the kinds of skills that are relevant today. And these are core skills like digital marketing or cloud computing, cutting edge tech skills, but also can be courses like business English from the University of Washington just launched this week, where in many parts of the world, English is a huge transformer in terms of the kind of salary that you can command. They need a credential that will be respected by employers and will allow them to get access to these job opportunities. And the certificates that we're able to provide to these learners do, in fact, open doors. So actually, this number is out of date. I think at this point, 40% of course completers elect to earn a certificate. 70% of learners post their certificate on LinkedIn to the point that within a few months of launching this, Coursera is now the second largest provider of non-credit-bearing credentials right after Microsoft, which has been doing this for 25 years. And 75% of employers surveyed has said that they will recognize these certificates for hiring decisions. Another thing that it turns out to be incredibly valuable for learners is government endorsement, and we're starting to see that. So Singapore, which was the first to do this, had started with our data science specialization from Johns Hopkins and basically said, we will pay any data scientist who completes the specialization the price of the certificate plus a $200 bonus. Now, if you think about this from their perspective, they're paying $800 to create a full-fledged employable data scientist who can contribute to their 21st century economy. The salary that this person can command means that they recoup the $800 from the paycheck on the first salary, from the taxes on the first paycheck. And so it's an incredibly ROI positive endeavor for them. They're now broadening this to a much larger set of courses and specializations, not only from Coursera, but from others. And Malaysia is now following suit, which indicates that there is a real traction for this in a variety of countries. So this is great. And I've talked about the potential opportunity, but potential is only potential. Does this actually help? So in order to do that, we did a survey on course completers who had completed the course 3 months or longer ago, and we asked them, did these courses benefit you? This was published at Harvard Business Review in September, and I'm gonna share some of the data with you. So as I already mentioned, 52% of learners said the career was their key motivation for taking courses. When we asked them, did this benefit you, 87% of them said yes. And they listed the specific benefit that they had gotten. 97% is a large, impressive number in itself. But I think even more impressive is this number over here, which is that 33% saw benefits that are sort of unarguable and measurable. So specifically, 26% found a new job that is higher paying than the one they had before. 9% started their own business. So this is benefit that they attribute directly to their online courses. The numbers, by the way, in emerging countries are much larger than this. Specifically, if you look at this, this is a graph that shows the benefits that people get in developed economies versus emerging economies. And you see that for emerging economies, the number is actually close to 45% of people who had gotten benefit, compared to only about 30% in developed economies. And what's also interesting is that the lower your socioeconomic status, self-reported, the more likely you are to benefit, again, in the emerging economies. As I said, this is only one of the motivations that we see. Another big one is education as a motivation. So 28% of learners worldwide said that academic advancement in a traditional path was their key motivation for taking these courses. And again, we asked them, did you benefit? And the answer was that 88% reported benefit of some kind or another from an educational perspective. Of these, 18% saw tangible educational benefits, specifically getting credit for these courses or being able to waive prerequisites. But I think we shouldn't dismiss the less tangible benefits. Specifically, I'd like to highlight the 38% who refreshed concepts before going back to school. A large population of these are people who, due to life circumstances, maybe having to care for a family member or having to earn a living for your family, dropped out of school and now are in a position in their life where they want to go back. And 38% said that this helped them go back to school. And I'll give an example of that at the end. So in fact, this is this last section. And this last section is intended to show you that these numbers, which, you know, numbers are all good, these are real people. All of these numbers are real people. I'm going to give you three examples of the three different kinds of learners, but these are just three of many, that and the kind of transformation that this can affect. So I'm going to start with Scotty. Scotty grew up in Alabama, was a star student in high school, got a full scholarship to attend UT Austin, but no one in his family had ever gone to college, and they said, what do you need this for? You need to go earn a living so you can help support the family. So he didn't take the scholarship and went to work as a taxi driver until the recession hit. And from one day to the next, he was laid off. He'd been living paycheck to paycheck, so he didn't really have any resources to fall back on. And so within a matter of months, he lost his house, he lost his wife, and eventually he lost custody of his 13-year-old daughter because he didn't have a place for her to sleep. As part of this downward spiral, Scotty said, if I ever get out of this, I'll make sure it never happens again. So he got a job as a horse groomer, and started Googling educational opportunities. Specifically, he was Googling, ironically enough, free college credit, which we don't offer, but it came up anyway. And he found the courses, and he started taking courses just to regain his confidence. And actually, he started with one of Dr. Chuck's courses on the history of the internet, and realized that he could actually do this, and regained enough of his confidence that he applied to a traditional university. He is now a graduate of Arizona State, the first person in his family to ever go to college, and is earning a living as a writer. He's a remarkably eloquent individual. I mean, you hear him speak, and it's just amazing to listen to him. And he's earning his living as a writer, which he never thought he could ever do. That's one. Very different, other side of the world, different kind of transformation. This is Charmin. Charmin Shahabuddin is an activist in Bangladesh whose friends were being sold into servitude to a husband or an employer, which is very common for girls in Bangladesh. She decided that she wanted to do something about that and was able to convince one, only one, of her friends to run away with her, and they opened the bakery. Unfortunately, neither Charmin nor her friend had any business background, and the bakery was floundering and making only $900 a month, which was not enough to support them. So someone told Charmin about online courses, and she started by taking a micro-econ class from Penn, a model thinking class from Michigan, and then some more courses from Irvine in Michigan, and eventually a marketing course from Wharton, and she learned how to run a business. So her bakery is now earning not $900, but $5,000 a month, which is enough to support not only her and her friend, but five other women, which she is now able to protect from a life of servitude. So this is, I think, a really exciting thing. And just as a coda to that, just last week, Charmin sent me an email saying that she'd been admitted to the INSEAD Business School in Europe and is now going to study in business school there, which I think is a really amazing thing. So the last one is the one that I promised you at the very beginning. This one brings tears to my eyes every single time. This is the story of Jerry. Jerry, I found out about by an email that went to my personal Stanford email account sent by his wife, Donna. And you can see the title, the subject of the email, Coursera Program Has Changed My Husband's Life. He has ALS. So we called Donna and to find out, because she obviously wanted to tell us more. Jerry was a healthy, vibrant, mid-40s man who started to lose sensation in his fingers. And he went to a doctor, and eventually he was diagnosed as having ALS. And over time, he lost the ability to move, first his hands, and eventually lost the ability to move anything except his eyes. So this is Jerry, whose only ability to communicate was via a tablet that tracks eye gaze. Jerry, this is a testimonial from Jerry's wife, Donna, about Jerry that I'm going to just read to you. Most people diagnosed with ALS get 18 months to live. They go home and fret, regret the things they have not done. But not Jerry. Coursera has inspired him. He stays up late into the night studying for tests instead of thinking about death. He's determined to continue his education. Our living room walls are papered with his certificates showing his high marks. Now, I want to highlight that the courses that Jerry took were not like lightweight, easy ones with multiple choice quizzes. He took programming classes. He programmed with his eyes alone. Think about the dedication and persistence that you need to have that happen and the impact that it had on his life to have that as something that keeps him going. So Donna called me a few months ago and told me that Jerry had sadly eventually passed away after several years of being ill. But she said that this really helped transform the last years of his life. So to me, this is part of the effort that Anat and others here are taking to help make the lives of people who are not as fortunate as those of us in this room and make their lives better. So I'm going to end with one of my favorite quotes, which is by H.G. Wells, who said that history is a race between education and catastrophe. And together with you and other institutions, we hope to help humankind win that race. Thank you very much. question was, could I talk about the financial structure? We are funded by investors. That's what's kept us going. In 2013, as a first step towards becoming a sustainable enterprise that doesn't rely on investment or on philanthropy, we launched certificates and courses. The certificates, the course content is free. The certificates have a cost. It's a modest cost. It ranges from maybe $50, which is often discounted to $30 in developing countries, up to, for the more career-oriented courses, it can go, Wharton, for instance, charges $95, and that's kind of the high end of the range. You don't have to get a certificate. You can just browse the course for free. But these certificates, as I mentioned, have considerable market value. And so in the courses that have market value, such as the, for instance, machine learning specialization, we see a very large percentage of people who opt to pay for that certificate so that they can put it on the resume. This is something that a year ago, if you'd asked me if this is going to turn into a viable business model for us, I would have said, I don't know, we're hopeful, but we don't know. But with the launch of very many specializations in September, including the machine learning one and a bunch of others, big data, business analytics from Wharton, and so on, we are very optimistic that this is going to be something that can sustain us and allow us to continue to offer free education. And then the last thing I wanted to say is that the revenue that comes in from these courses is split 50-50 between us and the institution that provided the course.
I've seen several hands, so one by three.
One of your slides said that about 25% of folks didn't have a bachelor's degree yet. How does that break down across countries? Is that mostly in developed countries or mostly in?
Yes. So in developed countries, the population tends to skew older and more educated. In developing countries, it tends to skew younger. In countries like India and Latin America, it tends to skew towards the younger pre or during college age.
So thank you for being here. You're very inspiring. There is a gap for people who have been in the workforce for several years, and generally people that have been out of college for a couple of decades, and now they need to be refreshed or find out the latest information. Are you seeing a demand for, you know, the adult learner and in that area of course activity?
Absolutely. So, I mean, the question was, do we see an interest in the adult learner, people who are out of college and are now in the workforce? And that is the large majority of our learners. You saw the 25 to 34-year-old age range is 44%, and then there is a long tail of even older learners. Those are exactly the ones that feel like the skills they have are not the ones they need today. And that's why courses like data science, digital marketing, machine learning, big data are the ones, business analytics are the ones that receive the greatest amount of traction, because these are the skills that one needs today. Mostly they didn't exist when people went to school. And business technology and data are cross-cutting disciplines that exist in all sectors of the economy, which is why we see such a huge demand for those.
Do you guys collaborate with Khan Academy in any sort of way?
The question was, do we collaborate with Khan Academy? Sal is a good friend, and we communicate, but we don't have any kind of serious collaboration. They're mostly focused on the K-12 space, and we're on the university space. There's a little bit of overlap in that some of our content kind of trickles down into high schools, and some of his content sort of trickles up into early university. But these are largely, I think, parallel efforts, and we have the greatest respect for the work that Sal does.
I'm not sure the integrity of learner assessment.
The question was, how do we ensure the integrity of learner assessment? And so we have a partial answer to that. We have the keystroke and webcam verification for ensuring the identity of the learner at the keyboard. So that the way this works is, when the learner enrolls in the course for a certificate, we take a picture of them via their webcam and also compare it to their picture ID, which they upload, and we ensure that they are who they say they are. And then at the same time, we also measure their keystroke pattern, which it turns out is pretty distinctive. It's not as distinctive as a fingerprint, but it's very hard to forge. And so that allows us to ensure that when they submit their quiz, they are who they say they are. Now, is this a foolproof mechanism for academic integrity? No, of course not. They can still get on the phone with a friend and get the answers from them. But the truth of the matter is, your University of Washington students can do the same, and many of them probably do. So it's not a complete solution. I will say that in some ways, we probably have less of that than might happen in college campuses, because the purpose of these certificates are for employability. And if you say that you've taken Carlos's and Emily's machine learning specialization, and you walk into an interview, and the interviewer asks you a basic machine learning question, and you don't have a clue, that's not going to get you very far. And so there's, I think, less value to cheating than there is in the context of a high-stakes college assessment, where all you care about in the end is that you have the diploma, and no one's going to really go back and check. So I don't know. It's not a full answer. I recognize that.
Let me ask a question here. So the structure of the class that we're teaching online is very different than what we do at the university. Other than flipped classrooms, do you have any other suggestions for us in terms of how some of the ideas might percolate into teaching in an academic setting?
That's a really great question. So Carlos was asking, are there other ways for someone who's teaching a MOOC and it's very different from how you teach on campus that you would bring the ideas back into your class? And I think one of the most important aspects of this, and I've had this conversation with a number of instructors, is they say, well, clearly our MOOC audience is different than our on-campus audience, which means we have to teach them differently. We have to be much more engaging. We have to teach them content that's much more relevant and directly applicable to their goals. And that's why we need to teach differently in terms of the content and the presentation than we do to our on-campus students. To which I asked them, look, it's not actually the case that your on-campus students don't benefit from more engaging pedagogy or don't want the content to be relevant to their careers. It's just that they don't have a choice. So really, when I taught at Stanford, and I, you know, there were a bunch of undergraduates who were inflicted with my course, they didn't know what was relevant to their careers because they were like 20 years old. I didn't know what was relevant to them in their future life because I didn't get to interact with a lot of people who had those needs, which means I didn't have the opportunity to really shape the curriculum to be as relevant and useful as possible. So one thing that I tell MOOC instructors is forget even flipped classroom. Once you understand from your MOOC learners that this is a concept that's really beneficial to someone in the workforce, maybe you should think about teaching that to your on-campus students as well, because even if they don't know it, they will benefit from it once they're out of school. And I think this is probably the biggest lesson that you can take with you, is you can use your MOOC learners as sort of a little test bed for learning about what could benefit your on-campus students.
That was a reception in the CSE 8.